Odaiba Marine Park, the venue for the triathlon at the Tokyo 2020 Games. Three events to be decided here in the coming days. First up, it's the men in what has all the ingredients for a cracking race. 1.5 kilometer swim, 40 kilometers on the bike, a 10K run. It promises to be fast, to be furious, and to be very, very exciting indeed. Alistair Brownlee won the event in Rio in a time of 1 hour and 45 minutes. In London, he won it in 1 hour and 46 minutes. This time round, there will be a new Olympic champion, and the conditions will be tough. The air temperature of 27 degrees, the humidity at 67%. The event moved to start at 6:30 in the morning local time to try and avoid the harshness of the Tokyo afternoons. So who might it be? Well, it could be Vincent Louis from France, the man in form. Mario Mola of Spain, the world ranked number one. Tyler Mislichuk of Canada, winner of the test event here in 2019.
And then, of course, there are always veterans. And in Javier Gomez, we have Mr. Popular. What an amazing story. Out of the sport, forced out of the sport with heart problems for such a long time. Injuries have interrupted him every time the Olympics have come around. Will this be the year? And then the other scale is the 23-year-olds, Alex Yee and Hayden Wilde. The imposter syndrome, he calls it, Alex Yee, in the shadows of the Brownlees. And they inspired him to be here. Now he competes with Jonathan, not Alistair. We'll talk about that, of course, during the call. And Hayden Wilde from New Zealand. Rio inspired him, and now he is here. Can he do it at such a young age? So many people with so many chances.
It's a wide open race, and it is a beautiful setting at Odaiba Marine Park. And you think of the great images at the Olympic Games, the start of the men's eight in the rowings, whether it's the slow motion pictures from the diving or the gymnastics. Well, the start of a triathlon, that mass of humanity, as it tries to find its way in the opening hundreds of meters.
There's Russell White from Ireland, the last man to come into the field there. Broke his collarbone mid-2020. So many of these athletes as well with interrupted preparations. But you're right, this is great. The excitement that builds here, just minutes away from the start of the Olympic triathlon. Not 4 years, 5 years preparation for this one, of course.
And that preparation, as we all know, has been significantly interrupted. And that is what means that this race is so wide open. We're not quite sure. The athletes aren't quite sure where they are in terms of their arrival to the start line. Some of the athletes, particularly from the Southern Hemisphere, haven't been able to travel to some of the events that were on. And therefore, we're not quite sure where they are in their cycle. And, well, you look at the start list and you listen to the experts, and here is the course.
Well, Tokyo Triathlon track, it's tight, turning, technical, it's terrific. There's no doubt about it. There's that swim. They jump out of the water back onto the pontoon, two laps, that's unusual. Then onto the bike ramp for the run. It's good, eight laps of 5Ks for the ride, eight laps of 5Ks. There are 16 turns in amongst there. It's really hard and really technical. The guys don't get a chance to relax. Hit about 60Ks there. That's the fastest part of the course before it turns back to that bike path in blue, as you see. And there's the finish, and that's where the run begins. Four laps of 2.5Ks on the blue beach path to begin. Five turns, two straightaways. And then we come back on for a final 400 metres that will decide the medals, Tokyo 2020.
That's the graphic, and that is the reality. And you listen to the journalists who are involved in triathlon month in, month out. You listen to the past champions, those with a pedigree in the sport. And the one thing that they can all agree on is they can't agree on who is going to win this event. There are 10, 12, 15 names even being considered for the medals in Tokyo 2020's Olympic men's triathlon.
Well, the one thing we are sure of is there will be a new Olympic champion. Alistair Brownlee, of course, Well, back-to-back triathlon golds, how good is that? In London, of course, in his home games, and then again in Rio. He tried to qualify, moved into Ironman after Rio, then wanted to be back, wanted to have another go at this, but just couldn't quite get it, couldn't qualify. His brother Johnny is here, and Alex Yee, the youngster, as mentioned, in the lineup for Team GBs. We have a look at the start list.
Mario Mola is the world ranked number one, wearing 22 for Spain. Vincent Luis, well, he's the man in form, and you go down this start list and you look at the name of Alex Yee and the young man from New Zealand, Hayden Wilde, two men who could come from the shadows into the golden light.
Three Australians in the field, the only nation Australia to qualify three in both men's and women's triathlon in 2020. But so many nations with opportunities here to medal, and as mentioned, so many of them with the chance to go for gold. The conditions not quite as hot as all of these guys work towards, really hot and humid conditions, and in the end, the morning has rolled out not too bad. That humidity around 67%, that's okay.
It is, and the temperature will increase. We're expecting it to be close to 30 by the time we get into the run. There'll be 51 starters in this men's individual triathlon. There is a mixed relay event later in the week, and a couple of the individual qualifiers have pulled out of the individual events in both the men's and women's competition to save themselves for that mixed relay. There were 55 competitors scheduled to start, just 51 actually will.
Number seven, look out for that man, Vincent Louis. He is a star. No reason that he couldn't take this on from the very beginning. It's so interesting, this sport, though, the tactics, how you go about it. Do you want to be out on your own? Do you want to be part of a bike breakaway? And so often it just comes down to that run.
And it's going to be interesting to see if there's any sort of team tactics. A couple of nations with three competitors, will one sacrifice in order to help the compatriot, whether that be on the bike or to hold back and to take them through on the run? It is very much an individual sport, but there may well be some team tactics as this race unfolds. Wearing number 20 for Spain is Fernando Alarza, fourth in Leeds in June 2021. And that Leeds race is really the form guide that people are looking to as we head into this. But the difference between the humidity in Leeds in the United Kingdom and Tokyo at the Olympics is significant.
43 there, Blummenfelt, and there's Mario Mola. He is a star. He is the number one in the world, three-time World Triathlon Series champion. And there's some pressure on him, no doubt about that, as there are on all of these athletes. But it's interesting in triathlon and the scene we've set for you, there are so many with ability. They all got ability, that's why they're here, but so many with the ability to win this. The pressure, if you like, has been shared as they reach the pontoon and they will be ready to go momentarily to begin the 2020 Olympic triathlon. Richard Varga has led the swim in the last two Olympic Games. He's not here, so they've got to find someone else to lead the chase. Brownlee is very good normally. We look to the Russians as well from the ROC, Igor Polyansky. He was out with Varga in Rio. So again, even that tactical choice is who goes for it and who do you step in behind, just sets up the race.
Got a shot momentarily ago of Morgan Pearson, who's also got to be part of the conversation, from the United States, wearing number 53. But we're just about set to go. Who will it be? They're off and swimming at the men's triathlon for Tokyo 2020. All the ingredients are there. Let's see how it bakes in the heat of Tokyo.
Now, this is a false start. This is drama aplenty at the Odaiba Marine Park. As you can see, the outside and a couple on the inside maybe have gone, and half the field is still on the podium.
And they're trying to get to them.
They're trying to get them and get them back. My goodness me, what happens here?
Wow.
Here's the boat now.
We'll try and get across them as quickly as possible, and you can see they're starting to get their heads up. Those at the front will wonder what's going on. They have no clue that half the field, at least half the field, have been left back on the pontoon. And that is, well, it's simply remarkable to see that.
Absolutely. They did seem to go very, very quickly. And I think it's a little bit, once one goes, it's a domino effect. It started from the outside, and what happens to the athlete that went first. So we'll get a look at those on the outside that did go, and what an advantage this is for the athletes on the inside that didn't go. And that's the majority of the favourites that have drawn on the inside. They chose to be on the inside of the pontoon, and wow, what an advantage that may turn out to be.
Absolutely, in that burst of adrenaline, and often in the triathlon, the first 200, 300 metres in particular, it's, well, the fibres are twitching and you just go, and the adrenaline kicks in, and takes 300-400 metres for it to settle down and for the strokes and the composure to come. But those athletes have already, well, they put in a good 100, 150 metres there before they were hauled back, if not a bit more.
Yeah, this is incredible. And Henry Schoeman, Jonathan Brownlee, Morgan Pearson, amongst those that were drawn wide and deliberately drawn wide, and they went. And let's have a look at who went first here as they set. That's incredible. They almost went as one on the outside, and Mario Moeller, I think, on the very inside. What did they hear? Well, that is madness.
It is, and it's very disconcerting for all those athletes who've gone and have had to haul themselves back and set themselves up again. I wonder how much time, if any, they'll be given before we restart. Doesn't look like much at all.
Blummenfelt, the world number three, went in, so the nervous energy has become nervous anxiety now for half the field.
So for the second time of asking, we're set to go at the start of the men's triathlon.
This is messy. They were ready and then were told that they're in the starter's hand and there's some seconds to go. Composure here. There'll be stories at the end of this about the athletes likely to medal will all say the same thing. I was able to keep my composure amidst the drama of the beginning of the 2020 Olympic triathlon. Goodness gracious me.
Taking a long time. All the athletes ready to go. And this time, they all go. And for the second time of asking, we are off and running at the men's triathlon at Tokyo 2020. And there is an amount of wash as the athletes try to get themselves into the positions that they will have thought about, worked on, and considered as the best for their strategy going into this race.
And more than ever before, these guys need to relax. They need to get into a rhythm and try to relax. Their minds racing well ahead of the speed that they're swimming at after that amazing start. And let's have a look at it again, how it went down. The middle seemed to go first, didn't it? And then to the right went, and to the left sort of didn't.
That was an even break by comparison to what happened before. And, well, it's hard to imagine just how important every moment of this. You feel with 1.5 kilometers in the water and 40 kilometers on the bike and 10 kilometers on the run, there's a little bit of room for error, but not so in the modern day triathlon, where every single inch and every single moment counts in the hour of 46, 47, 48 minutes.
And that's Henry Schoeman on the inside in 51, the South African, that is often very good on the swim leg. And you'll see these guys, they're trying to sort themselves out now. They'll come towards the turn and be as one, but at the moment still trying to work their way across. There are six boys. That's the halfway mark of the first leg in what is an interesting, very interesting and different swim course. The 1.5 k's doesn't change, but it's two laps, the first of 950 meters. Then they come out of the water back onto the pontoon before they dive in again for a 550 meter lap.
Yeah, Schumann, of course, was bronze medalist behind the Brownleys in the Rio Olympics. And there you see two distinct groups, those that started on the near side, those that started on the far side, and now the strokes have begun to settle down. There's a smoothness in the turnover, not quite as frantic, and at the front, well, so often the arrowhead forms, and where Schumann is on the hips of
Diego Moya from Chile, who's got away as well, very well. It's no great surprise there. Brownlee on the other side amongst those going well, but right now the early lead in the triathlon goes to Diego Moya.
Diego Moya leads out Schumann behind him, and Schumann just taking that drag, just slightly easier to fall in behind at the hips or at the knees of the swimmer in front, creates a little bit of the drag and just makes it just that little bit easier on this swim. But as you say, the most concerning part of this swim for those that are strong swimmers is the fact that they've now hit their tempo, they've now hit their stroke rate, but quickly approaching is the requirement to get out of the water and go back in again and to re-establish that stroke rate. And it's not an easy thing to do when you hit your rhythm and you have the feel of the water. To have to interrupt that and start again is a real challenge.
The Moy leads as they round the first of the boys. They turn right here and then right again in about 20 metres. So the field comes together for the first time here.
Look at that. What a sight. A mass of athletic humanity around the first boy.
Mass of Olympic dreams. Some already may be struggling and may be out of it, particularly with the false start that we saw. Unprecedented scenes at Olympic level at the beginning of this triathlon. But Moya, he's found his rhythm absolutely, and then it's a matter of who finds the slipstream behind him, and that will cascade and continue on. So around the second boy now as they head back towards the pontoon, looking back over Tokyo Bay here, the magnificent Tokyo Bay in the Odaiba Marine Park.
Yeah, it's a wonderful sight as Moya, Diego Moya, the 23-year-old, leads out the field, and you can see a significant distance already between first and last in this 51-man field. Moya, world rank number 60, and a noted strong swimmer. So this is not a surprise that he is to the fore at this early stage of the swim. Crucially, for those that are not, where swimming is their weakest of the three disciplines involved in triathlon, anything beyond 45 seconds to a minute behind, well, that's going to be a challenge.
And we're with Jonathan Brownlee, who, as always, is up there. He's never far away in the swim. He's never far away in any part, looking to win gold and follow in his brother's footsteps, give him the complete set. So you'd expect him to be there. Have a look at it. We've travelled 6 minutes now, and there's a margin already as that arrowhead has certainly taken place. And there is Tokyo at its brilliant best.
What a remarkable record for Jonathan Brownlee. As you say, second in Rio in 2018, third in London in 2012. World champion, of course, world rank number six. He has been ever present in triathlon for the last decade, and what a way it would be for him to round it out by winning gold here in Tokyo. But it is a monumental ask, particularly with the talent, none more so than his compatriot Alex Yee, the young man in waiting, won Leeds in 2021, which, as I said, is the marker for many in terms of form coming into this event. But winning on the circuit and winning at an Olympic Games are two utterly different requirements.
The boys, they're about to pass, as you can see there, halfway back on the return leg. As the field continues to work at it, Brownlee there, and importantly, Vincent Louis is right in amongst it. That was important for him. If he was going to lose it, it could have been just there. The world number three, ranked two in Olympic qualifying, the 32-year-old. Really has no weakness. The best athletes in the world in this event, the three disciplines. There's always some that they're stronger than, but Vincent Louis so good in all of them. And you're just pulling away a little bit, Diego Moya there, in terms of the pack behind him, just happy to let him do the work. And there's some big names there. Brownlee, Louis, Schoeman. As they head towards a right-hand turn that will bring them back towards the pontoon. That's spectacular. They have to get out of the water, jump up to the pontoon, and get back in again.
All the athletes have different areas of comfort. You think in the middle of that pack, maybe fifth or sixth, that no matter which way you turn your head to breathe, you're going to take in an amount of wash as you also try and keep an eye on the direction you're going in. More often, the comfort is to be on the extremities of that group, either left or right, allowing you to keep an eye when you breathe one way on the leaders and to also have a clear breath on the other side if you choose so, without any wash coming at you. But it's been a very impressive opening 800 meters or so from the Chilean Diego Moya.
And that's a big move from Vincent Louis. He's sitting to the right of pitcher there, right up with Moya, letting him just stay that half stroke ahead. And he's got clean water, he's got clear water. He's not going to get into any trouble. No one's going to whack into him. Schomburg there amongst them as well.
Well, the triathlon, obviously not a contact sport, but in the swim, you need sharp elbows. Going around those pontoons in particular, wonderful sight.
And Sadiq as well up there in the swim. There are some that the swim is cross your fingers and hope, try to get yourself in a position that you can come out and join up with the lead group in the bike early. There are others who'd look to break away. As we head there, to you can see that right-hand turn, then another before we jump back onto the pontoon. Now that will represent the conclusion of 950 metres of the 1.5k swim. So a second lap of 550 when they get back in the water.
Interesting again to watch the lead swimmers. Louis on the far side, his leg kick is far less significant than that of Moya, who leads. Often it was talked about in triathlon's earlier days about swimmers trying not to use their legs as much, with such a requirement for the legs in cycling and running, that no longer so. If you have a leg kick, you use it in swimming and to take advantage of the strength of your swim. But Vincent Louis very clearly just using that upper body strength to drag himself through the water.
Well, they're going to use their legs in a moment. This will be great. You can see they're on the pontoon momentarily. Just a chance perhaps to maybe look around and see who's there. But you worry about your own race, not worry about your opponent at this stage. So they sprint across the pontoon and dive back in again. Louis the first one out from Moya. Polyansky is there, and Schoeman as well.
Followed quickly through, and you'll see the names of your chosen athletes as they race through that pontoon. Tagged, and the gaps you now see at 16 and 17 in 20 seconds, they are significant gaps.
Pearson, one of those with a gap at 20 seconds now. We're looking at some of the favourites, Blummenfelt, Bert Whistle, Hayden Wilde is 23 seconds back. But again, it's not all of their strengths to many. It's just get through, survive. Look at those pitches.
Saw the name of Alex Yee going through as well. 22 seconds down. There is the man who has started best of the favourites, Vincent Louis, seventh in Rio. He trains with Mola, the Spaniard Mario Mola.
Who's 25 seconds back after the swim. He would like to have been closer than that, that's for sure. You don't lose it in the swim. You've got plenty of time, but you set yourself up. And that's a little further back than he'd like.
So, second part of the swim, having done 950 meters on the first lap, it's 550 meters in the second lap before we come into the very important transition area from swim to run. More on that a little bit later. For now, it's Louis and Schumann, world rank number two, the bronze medalist from 5 years ago, who follow Diego Moya from Chile, who leads out the race.
And remember, this second lap only 550 metres, so already they turn right around the first boy, turn again very quickly, and then head back for one more sharp right-hand turn before they can see that pontoon and touch it again. So those leaders after the first lap and in the water right now, Louis, Moya, Dominski, Polianski, Schumann, Schomburg, brother Igor Polianski, Taylor Reid from New Zealand is up there, Brownlee, of course, he's up there, Van Riel and Coggins from Hong Kong make up the top 10.
Well spotted.
So this is action stations now. If you want a jockey for position, this is your time to do it.
There are, of course, penalties available if any of the swimmers cut across or there's any infringements or infractions around those markers. Watched very, very closely. Not unusual to see triathletes penalized at times during the swim, but no sign of anything yet, and that is a very, very impressive sight as Vincent Louis takes up the tempo at the front of the swim, at the front of the race, and you can see beautiful gliding action, power coming through the shoulders and the chest as he drags his body through the water.
And he's got a nice group behind him. You don't want to end up, it's nice to be in front, I suppose, out of the swim, but if you're on your own, then you're on the bike on your own and you're doing all the work. So Louis will want a group of five or six, ideally, to go with him when they get through T1 and take off on the bike. So he's certainly put himself in clean water. It's his race, isn't it? No one's going to affect me on the swim. If I've got the opportunity, this is what I'm going to do. That was the plan, and at this stage, it's working.
And he set out his stall from the very beginning. He's decided he's going to, as is his wont, to dominate from the front and to say to the others, if you want it, you're going to have to come past me from the very beginning. And he really has turned up the heat in this 550-meter part of the swim. And he stretched them out. And what it will do as well as bringing a couple with them, those that were behind and struggling a little bit may find themselves distant just that bit more by the pace of the Frenchman.
The first time the field rounded these final two boys, there was about the distance of the boys in the field. It's certainly stretched out now. So there's some athletes at the back of the pack that had given up 20 plus seconds after the first lap that have given up a little bit more to these leaders, including Vincent Louis from France, the 32-year-old who trains in the USA. You knew he'd been training hard, and we can see it right here. No real weakness in the three disciplines for Louis, that's for sure. But this is a really, really big swim for him. The test event back in 2019, of course. The swim was 18:32 the time.
Yeah, that's
what
event,
it is here.
That test event won by Tyler Mislechuk, the Canadian. Kasper Stoners of Norway, second. Hayden Wilde, a young man with a big pedigree, third.
And now you can see the distance here as those at the back of the pack after the swim leg have really given up a huge amount of space to those leaders. Look at them now, single file as they head to the pontoon. They're up and onto the ramp and into transition.
Heading towards the final 100 metres or so of the swim of 1.5K in the men's triathlon at the Tokyo Olympics. And it's a race led by France's Vincent Louis, the former world champion, of course. And out of the water he comes. And is that Polyansky behind him of the Russian Olympic Committee? Schumann, the bronze medalist from 5 years ago, was there as well.
Brownlee's there. Look at that, just 10 seconds away. Moya continued on. They head into all-important transition here. Another place where, well, you don't lose the race unless you get it horribly wrong and end up with a penalty.
So into transition, and they will head towards their assigned positions in transition. It'll be a quick adjustment to put down the hat and goggles. They must place them in the area that they're assigned, on with a helmet. And they will roll the bike. They're not allowed to mount their bikes until they hit the designated line on the blue carpet.
So Mario Moya has given up 40 seconds in the end in that swim leg. Mola not great at all in there, as we'll look back over those times as we continue to head through transition.
And straight to the bike they go, and a group of five have slipped away, and that really is a perfect number for a group to try and build a lead at the front of a triathlon. It'll be interesting to see what happens behind in terms of whether they become fractured groups with threes and fours, or whether a peloton of sorts forms and they can go in chase. But plenty of time for that to settle down. But the Frenchman, Vincent Louis, as he has from the opening 300 or 400 meters of the swim, is now at the front. Brownlee in the group behind. And they, well, it's 8 laps of 5 kilometers. Often in that first lap, the riders will just take a check on the wind conditions, where it's coming from, a tailwind, a crosswind, where might I be able to attack, although they'll have seen the course in race conditions just like this. Are there opportunities that I haven't seen before? And there is how tight it is.
Looking back after the swim, Morgan Pearson of the USA gave up 20 seconds to Vincent in 20th position. Blummenfelt was 25 seconds behind. So these guys start to form the chase group on the bike. Alex Yee was 30 seconds back. Jacob Birkwistle, 34. Hayden Wilde gave up 38 seconds. And as mentioned, Mario Mola in the end, 41 seconds back in 39th position coming out of the water. Some of the big names with some work to do.
Just a shot there of one of the Sagiv brothers from Israel. Two sets of brothers, actually, in this men's triathlon, with Ran and Sashar Sagiv from Israel and Dmitry and Igor Polyansky from the Russian Olympic Committee team. And Dmitry Polyansky, as you can see, in that lead group.
It's the field moves past some of the landmarks on this Tokyo Bay Odaiba Marine Park track, including the giant anime Gundam. It looks down as they snake their way around. 8 laps of 5Ks. There are 17 turns including two hairpin bends. No real chance to relax for these guys as we look at the chase group, and it's a distinct group as well. So we've got the lead group and a chase group of 10 or 12. And they've got the work to do. It's not quite cobblestones there, but you can hear through the effects mics, there are parts of the track that are a little bit rough.
Settling into rhythm now. And you're right, you can hear that rattle. Do not adjust your sets. It's the cobblestone-like underneath the wheels of the cyclist and motorbike.
It's a technical track, this one. It really is. You can see those turns, how tight they are. Like elastic bands, if you like. If you can get out quickly, you can shoot forward once you get through. But they'll work together, this chase pack, as they go around the first of the hairpin bends, the big right-hander that sets them down on about a 900-metre run here, really the only time where they can get the speed up.
Well, 11 in that group, or 10 in that group, and you can see when the first rider goes round and hits the power again and shoots away, it can open up a bit of a gap on those behind, and they well may be the opportunities if anyone is thinking of attacking.
So the only chance is they disappear under that tunnel where the bike goes. About, there's a drop of about 10 metres where they can get some pace up. As we look at some of the pictures, including that of Polyansky, who's a surprise member of this lead group after the swim, and also Schumberg, who was fast out, and then that all-important transition. There's Pearson in that second group. They're about 25 seconds back, including Alex Yee as well. Not a worried look on his face at all, but things will have to start to happen for that first chase group on the bike soon enough.
Yeah, you mentioned Dmitry Polyansky. He's the elder of the two brothers. 22nd in Beijing, 21st in London, 32nd in Rio. This is fourth Olympic Games. And a long, long way to go, but he's put himself in a good spot as this cycle leg continues, and that gap is enclosed up to maybe 8. I'll get a full count on it now in a moment.
So the leaders turn right and head back towards the beach and the swim leg. They'll turn left after this bend and back onto the blue beach path, which leads them to the finish about 400 metres from there. So again, another example, it's not a huge straightaway by any means. They have to find their position before they turn and get onto the path. And there's a good look at the chase group, a large chase group now, that you'd think over the 40Ks will be able to wheel them in soon enough if that's what they like. Or is there a tactical move up front? Do they try to put a space on these guys?
Well, there are a number of these athletes who will be quite happy if this comes down to a foot race to finish rather than a gap that they have to close. So a significant group at the front doesn't have a breakaway will suit some rather than others, and as the race unfolds, it'll be interesting to see who feels they're going to need some sort of lead going into that run in order to continue their chance of a medal.
So it's 16 seconds the gap. That's official, 16 seconds only the gap between the first pack and Yee is at the head of that lead pack at the moment. A large pack, Pearson, again, is part of that. And then they start to space out a little, but it's quite a large pack. Bert Whistle has been able to move up now, just 23 seconds back. And Mola still 37 seconds behind. So not part of that first chase pack for the world number one. The leaders out in 25-23 with their first lap on the bike. This group works together now. You said it's so technical, right? Too many opportunities to take off with a couple of others and try to power away and get away, continually on the brakes around the tight turns. Such a mind game, the sport of triathlon. Do you have the confidence to go? Who will go with you? And many of these athletes can and do work together. Louis had talked about this. He said his fellow Frenchman and Belgian Martin Van Riel will come with me if there's a breakaway. He mentioned Australia's Aaron Royal as well, a training partner of Heat. He's got plenty of mates at the moment.
So then Reed and Brownlee, Polyansky, the German Schomburg, Van Riel, Louis, Schumann, and Mislichuk. Some of the names that we were expecting to see towards the front of this triathlon. A couple that we were expecting are a little bit further back down the road.
Including Taylor Reid's teammate, Hayden Wilde. We expected a New Zealander might be on the front pack. We didn't think it would be Taylor Reid. 38 seconds back after the first lap on the bike for the young Kiwi. Not that Taylor Reid's old. He's just 24 years of age.
Yeah, Hayden Wilde's very much one of those who would like to see a group form, slow it down a little bit. No one breaks away and it turns into a foot race, because if it does become that, well, then that young New Zealander would have a really strong opportunity to medal. But this group, not working particularly hard together, but doing enough to establish that lead. Nine of them around that very tight corner. There are many tight corners, as you can see.
Great sounds. It's unfortunate that we can hear all of those sounds as clearly as we can, because normally, of course, in an Olympic triathlon, the entire course would have fans everywhere. Not the case here in the pandemic-affected Tokyo Olympic Games. The chase group work together and they get a good look at each other there. So the lead group heading down the longest of the straightaways as the chase group were coming the other way around the hairpin bend, and they're all heading back towards the start finish area now on lap two. So they all know exactly where they are. Under the tunnel there, they disappear for the shortest of time. So there's, as mentioned, they go down an incline of about 10 metres very quickly, but then have to come back up it as well through the tunnel, as speeds under there reaching some 60 k's. They work now back up the hill, jockeying for position, just looking around. Whose turn is it?
You can see the chasing group emerging from behind. And that visual, so often in the triathlon, a thing of beauty.
Certainly is for Taylor Reid. He would be loving this, riding alongside Vincent Louis in the lead group at the Olympic Games. As the leaders head towards the finish of their second lap, the second of eight laps on the bike, and now beyond.
very hard as well with this technical course, this tight course, to get that drag that we so often see in cycling, where one comes through and there is a momentum to it. One takes a turn at the front, the next comes through, and because of those corners and the requirement to readjust the fluidity of the movement, not what you would see on a more open and straightforward cycle course.
So there's that gap again as the leaders turn left, and that chase group, it's still large. Doesn't appear to have made much ground in this lap. No need to really when there's a group that big. He'll turn. There's some fans there. The Athletes Village not too far away from there, and Team GB house, or an administrative part of the Team GB group, is right on that turn. So lots of support as they come back around. Schomburg, Van Riel, Brownlee, Schumann, Reed. Nenea also from Japan, the Australian-born Japanese athlete, becoming a citizen of Japan only a few months ago, and he's in the lead group.
Yeah, first at the Asian Tri Nations Championship in April of this year, and as you say, formerly represented Australia, now representing Japan, and in part of that lead group. Another surprise for me in that lead group is Jonas Schomburg of Germany. Did have a decent outing in Leeds earlier on this summer, 10th there, world ranked number 16. The swim, probably the strongest part of his triathlon. Having got himself into a good position out of the water, he's latched into the lead group.
Continue to report on the world number one for obvious reasons. Mario Mola remains 34 seconds back, so he's not part of that chase group, nor is Hayden Wilde, as mentioned. Two of the athletes who perhaps bigger things, well, definitely bigger things were expected of, that are caught out the back at the moment.
Situation for them now is they've got to figure out a way of organizing themselves and others around them to give chase in a meaningful way if they have any ambition of meddling at these games.
So the pace on the bike has certainly slowed. We're hearing that Pearson of the USA will have to wait when he gets onto the run for 15 seconds. I think he was penalized for a transition error. Need confirmation of that.
Yeah, there are very clear rules around what you can and can't do in the transition areas, including the mounting and dismounting of your bike, also where you leave your swim hat and goggles, etc., from the swim. And confirmation well picked up. Pearson is going to get a penalty, and that will be delivered as he leaves the bike and enters into the run.
You can see there snaking along the bike path. And these guys, they're not going in a pedestrian fashion, but they're certainly not racing yet. They've got the two groups and they're just sitting there just at the moment, not wanting to expend too much energy. We spoke about the heat, and they worked so hard in preparation for this, all of the athletes, many of them working in a lot of work through saunas and heat tents, if you like, to try to acclimatize themselves, and choosing their races to ensure that they worked in the heat of Mexico and Hawaii. But today's not too bad, the temperature edging towards 27, 28 degrees as it's just past 7 o'clock in the morning local time here in Tokyo. The humidity, again, at around 60, 70%, much better than it could have been.
Depends on what part of the world you're from. 27, 28 degrees, not bad for you. For some of us, that's unbearable.
And there's Pearson, who's dropped off that group all on his own. He's not aware of the penalty that will come. So the lead group continues on the bike. Look at those turns. They're tight on the brakes and then try to create some power. And if you're caught out on your own, it's, it can become particularly difficult. The left-hand hairpin bend as they now look at the longest of the straightaways.
When you talk about the preparation and the form, you look at that lead group and you look at Tyler Mislichuk, who, of course, won the test events here on this course in, well, it was back in 2019, but still it was done in the heat and in the humidity and under these conditions. And the Canadian comes into this race world rank number 7, 15th in Rio. He's got the track record and he's got the experience around this course, and you wonder just how much that might stand for as the race develops.
Well, Martin van Riel from Belgium, part of that lead pack, cycling is his strength. And I mentioned earlier that Vincent Louis and van Riel are part of a training group, so he'd be very, very happy. The world number 3, number 2 ranked Olympic athlete, with the way this lead pack is shaping up, there'll be plenty to share the work, including van Riel, as that lead group turns once again and heads back towards the finish. Schomburg, van Riel, Brownlee, Schumann, Reed.
Schomburg has been working particularly hard for this group, this lead group. He will know that he's got to get every ounce out of the advantage of being in this lead group if he's going to medal, and he's prepared to put that effort in. Others will benefit from it as well. Sitting at the back is Polyansky, the member of the Russian Olympic Committee team, quite happy just to be dragged along. Roads around Tokyo, around this area, closed down from early this morning. 7:15 in the morning local time, it's approaching. Roads, as we came in at 4:35 a.m. this morning local time, were shut down, and everyday life continues around this triathlon event.
Chase group there, get some water in. So important. You get what you can. Some electrolytes in early in the run. Just give yourself every chance. So there's the turn back onto the blue beach path, beach ramp that takes them to the start finish. And the conclusion of the third lap as they cross that red line. And there you can see Schumann, van Riel, Brownlee, Nina, that's interesting to see him up there. Louis, Mislichuk in amongst that group. Schomburg, Polyansky, a group of 9 who have a gap. It was 16, now 12 seconds. Feeling they're just sitting there. They could move up at any time, but the two groups are just happy to work separately for now. Pace of that lap, 39.10, so again slowing.
And then a couple of riders in no man's land before we go through to the gap, almost 30 seconds back, and you can see Mola part of that, and Wilde also part of that group. 30 seconds, not an insurmountable gap at this moment in time.
Yeah, that's they've made up some, that's for sure. They've realised, okay, we've got to do something, we've got to push. And you wonder when this lead pack may think the same. Certainly not conserving energy, but there is a long way to go, of course, but very cognizant of the fact that this is going to come down to the run, as always.
The third group with Mola in it also has his compatriot Fernando Alarza, 18th in Rio, consistent top 10 finisher at series events around the world. So Mola has a colleague in that third group. We talked about the potential for teammates to work together, and it'll be interesting to see the Spaniards with 3 athletes in this field, along with the Australians, the French, 3 also there from Norway. but it's Reed. And it's Brownlee, Polyansky, Schumberg, Van Riel, Louise Schumann, Mislachuk, and Nehmer in that front group of nine as they head out once more.
You just stretched out to single file there. That's the best way to get around these tight turns. You don't want to get into any trouble. The last thing you want here is to catch a wheel and go down, and that would be the end of your Olympic campaign. So honour amongst thieves, if you like, working together, knowing their place amongst that group. They want to stay there. They'd love to have that gap and build on that gap. This lead bike group, far from any guarantee the medalists are going to come from this group at all, but they're in a good position and they know it. Reed works up the front, just looks around. They continue to look around and they're starting to look at these guys. The chase group is making a move. They're going to become one any second, you would think. I think they knew this all along, hence the pace had slowed, and now that nine will become almost 29.
Well, you can see the urgency in that second group, even the body language. When you looked at group one and you looked at group two, you could see there was just that little bit more effort coming from the second group as they look to bridge that gap and close this down. And as you say, a group of nine will become a group of closer to 30 very, very soon, you feel. And when that happens, well, in sections like this, you wonder if somebody can get themselves to the front of a group of 29, 30, would they want to launch themselves down the road and try and create a gap going into the run? The other option, of course, is that they just stay together and the whole bunch go into the run and turn this into a foot race.
Yep. They can't all win, so you wonder and expect that someone may push on the bike. And well, look at that now. So that's one group now. They've joined up. That's it. And one big long snake heading down the main straightaway, down the Shooto Expressway. The slight decline gives them a moment to get the speed up a little. And they've done that. That lead group just pushed and extended it to a few seconds. They're going to make them earn it, that's for sure. As we're looking closely at Jonas Schumberg at the front of the pack. Martin Van Riel close behind. Henry Schumann in amongst it. Reed from New Zealand. St. Louis is there. And Kenji Nenner, born in Perth, Western Australia, now competing for Japan in Tokyo.
Behind them, Brazilian, Israeli, the Austrian. Some of the pictures is the triathlon unfolds. Was another South African due to start in this. Richard Murray, fourth in Rio, but he pulled out of the individual event to focus on that relay event later in the week. How Schumann might want him around right now.
So these leaders turn right and right again, and that heads them directly back up towards the start-finish area and on back onto the blue track, that when they hit that on the run, they'll have 400 metres to go. They'd like to think that they've worked themselves out by then, but we've had a slight move here up the front, just deciding to up the pace. Just metres to go now before that left-hand turn. Here it is, and onto the blue. So that's on the beach. That's a ramp that's been purpose-built. And there, the group has officially joined as, well, almost as one.
You fear for them coming at that pace to quite as hairpin a turn as that, when you see them having to brake, that no one gets themselves into trouble. It's the Luxembourg Zakos who's found his way to the front.
It looks like when the group joined as one, he decided to have a moment in the sun and cross the line ahead of the field at the halfway mark. What a good idea.
Stefan Zekas, world ranked number 63. Last form of any from the 31-year-old was a 47th place in the Lisbon event in May of this year.
That would be an upset if he can hold his place up there, but I like the style. A lap time, 46.09.
So we are getting to the point where, as you say, not all these athletes can win medals. Some will understand, well, all will understand and know where their strengths are, and they will know the strengths of those around them. And if you feel that you're not going to be able to compete at the level required for the run, then at some point you have to make a decision to try and do something about it. And that would seem to be what Stefan Zekas has decided to do. The third group is, as you can see, beginning to close in, and well, the race will be all back together again in the next number of minutes if that continues. That said, Zekas out the front, and he's got away from that group, and it's now a reasonably established lead of maybe 6 or 7 seconds over the last 700 or 800 meters.
7 minutes, just a second under 7 minutes that last lap on the bike. Pretty much the same as lap three, and we wonder whether that pace will pick up. We'll see. I don't think they'll worry too much about the leader, but after the halfway stage, you can see that leaders of, well, the second and third placed riders at this stage just looking around, just wanting to know who's there, who's going to go, just to make sure that he doesn't get too far away.
Well, he's definitely made his move, and he's definitely made his mark as he gets out of the saddle, puts the power through, tries to extend out that lead. Very, very difficult to try and get away on your own.
There's Gundam there, the 20-meter tall giant anime. First released the TV series in Japan in 1979 and very popular here around Tokyo Bay. I know you're a fan. All eyes on the TVs around Japan, around the world at the moment, on these guys in the Olympic triathlon.
And you can see the third group has bridged the gap as well. And the three white vests with the yellow and red band of Spain are all in that group now. Such a strong team. Mola, Gomez, and Alarza, all with pedigree, all with the potential to take a medal.
Yeah, there was just the 18 seconds that Mola was back after that third lap. So he, perhaps unlike me, didn't panic. He was under control. I was more worried for the world number one than he was, I think. And he's right there amongst it. Transition's going to come right into this when we get there. We're still a little way to go, of course. And leading into there, I wonder whether those with, well, they've all got medal chances and medal hopes and dreams, but really want to be there for gold, will push ahead just to try to get away from that pack and create a few seconds that could make the difference.
It is bubbling up very nicely indeed.
Yep. So the last time we came around that hairpin bend, there was a slight gap. Now they're all joined up bar one. So out in front, doing more than enjoying his moment in the sun. Oh, as we've had our first incident, and that looked very much like it may have been Nabal of Austria. Yep.
It was, and one of the Germans, I think it was Nischlag, but heartbreak, heartbreak. All the effort, all the preparation, all the training, and one moment, and it's all gone.
Not exactly sure what happened in that incident, but the body language told us that there was no coming back, no getting back on the bike. And certainly on his bike up front is Stefan Zachhaus. He crossed the line in front at the beginning of this fifth lap, and he's going to be there at the end of it as well. So that's the end of the major straightaway as he turns left. Any second now. 51 the time when he did that, and maybe 10 seconds or more back is the rest of the field, knowing that the pedigree of this athlete is such that they don't have to worry. Well, they're worried, but they don't have to panic that someone's got away by any means. It's a surprise to see this guy out in front doing such a strong job at it.
All the big names line up behind him. Number 42. What went through your shot there was Mohamed Masso of Syria. A really interesting story. He's from Aleppo. He only left in 2015. And he qualified for this Tokyo Olympics under the new flag effort being made by World Triathlon, where slots are given to countries that are developing their triathlon program. But what a moment for him. And Mohamed Masso, the 28-year-old, sixth at the 2018 Asian Games, world ranked number 134 coming into this, and he is right in there.
Great picture this as Zachhaus hits the start finish line. There it is, the red line. So he's led for an entire lap. Great work. And he's got a couple of seconds only on the rest of the field, who are sorting themselves out. And the rest of the field is almost the entire field of 51. As we go through the times there, the chase group and the second chase group became one. And they're all just happy at the moment to let Zachhaus lead them out. So no time. There's Brownlee in there in that pack. They're all there. All the names are there. It's more who's not. And I think there'll be too many that have been left out. Van Riel doing the work early, back in the middle of the pack, but look how sizable it is. Now there we are. Schoenberg, who was in the lead pack out of the water, is 26 seconds back from the lead as they cross the line.
And the man who was in the lead during that swim, Diego Moya, at the back of the chasing bunch of leaders. 51 athletes of the 55 that were scheduled to start got to the start. Richard Murray of South Africa deciding not to go because of the mixed relay. And a couple of the Dutch athletes deciding not to go either. And unfortunately, from Belgium's point of view, one of the pre-race favourites, Gilles Jeans, the world-ranked number 9, was unable to participate due to a positive COVID test. There's Toff of Hungary.
With a moment to say hi to the family at home. Interesting, that's how relaxed he is. And perhaps it's a sign of the pace of this bike leg. They've, with such a big group, there's, you could suggest it's almost pointless pushing too hard. That last lap was 7 minutes 10 on the bike, so the slowest.
Yeah, tough. 33rd in Rio. He hasn't finished DNFs beside his last three outings on the circuit, but he's very comfortable, very relaxed, and seems to be enjoying his early morning jaunt around Tokyo in an Olympic final. Zachhaus continues to hold a lead of 7 to 10 seconds, no more.
He's worked hard, was ranked 19th when they left the water in a time of 17.56 for his swim. 17.39 was that lead time. Vincent Louis, so made up that ground and decided to push ahead. And the rest of the field just content to let him stay there. They're in essence keeping themselves out of trouble here is the main game, getting plenty of water in, taking the time because they've got the time. The race for medals certainly isn't on yet.
It's interesting to see the different styles in this bunch, because those that are in the front positions, particularly around third, fourth, fifth, sixth, they look comfortable and fluid on the bikes. You can see some at the back of that group, with the exception, of course, of Toth. They're working that little bit harder to keep the pace that's being set. Isn't a blistering pace. There has been a slight injection in the last couple of hundred meters, and it looks like Zakhaus has been reeled in.
You have to remember that there was, you know, there was up to a minute the gap between some out of the water and those that are now part of this pack. So the bike is almost letting the wheels go round before maybe there's a push. If it's going to come in terms of speed wise, it has to happen right now. But you get the feeling you'd only be doing the work for someone else. Just want to stay at the top of that lead pack as they head towards transition, especially. But still a long way to go here. That's heading towards the end of lap six with Luxembourg out in front, but only just. And there's Toff at the rear of that huge pack. And I think we're at the back of the field there.
Azerbaijani Rostiev Pevstov in that group that trails this significant bunch at the front.
Looks like Matthew Sharp's turn to lead the field. So that's the second of the hairpin bends there. The end of the longest straightaway. They head back down the hill, then turn right and right again before heading towards the blue path, the blue ramp that takes them home.
Yeah, Matt Sharp, the second of the two Canadians alongside Mislachuk. There is number 16, mixed relay bronze at the Commonwealth Games 2018. He's a big man, 6'4", world ranked 56 coming into this. And Toth continues to sit on the back of the lead group. This is playing into the hands of those that fancy the 10K, the strong runners. It's set up to be a foot race. If this continues, and onto the blue carpet once more.
400 metres to go from that point. The flags of all nations on the left-hand side, all 206 of them that you can see, as they just veer right once again. And when they get here on the run, they will be done. And you get the feeling there might be four or five or even more that will be in a pack, all with a chance to medal. So Blummenfelt it is that takes the honours. A massive pack. There'll be a lot that'll have 0-0-0 next to their name, and then 1s and 2 seconds. They are all in this together.
Yeah, Blummenfelt, winner in Yokohama earlier this year, 13th in Rio, world rank 13 going into this Olympic triathlon in Tokyo 2020. And the gap you can see It's just the amount of time that that enormous group has to get across the line. 37 athletes in that group with Toth at the back. And then Schomburg, who was with the leaders early on, 31 seconds back.
7 minutes 15 that lap. So again, the slowest that they are just going around. I wonder whether the last lap might find some pace. The interesting part, the real interesting part, will be the jockeying for position as they head towards T2, all-important second transition. It's no different than the start of the swim. It's as if they've all just jumped in the second time, not the first time, because that was a bit awkward. An amazing start to this triathlon. It's how quickly you forget. Half the field went into the water before the gun, or did half the field wait despite the gun? We're not quite sure, but there was a restart, we know that. And, well, they all seem to have composed themselves. That I don't think there's going to be too many, and that's nice to know. There's not going to be too many stories of my race was gone before I even started, or as I got in the water the first time.
And it was interesting to watch at the time. There was a calmness even from those that had gone the 200, 250 metres down the start of the swimming section. They just paddled back and nonchalantly got back on the start line for an Olympic Games and went about their business.
Andrea Selvesberg from Norway decides he might have a go of this out the front business and see what happens as we look back over Odaiba Marine Park and Tokyo Bay. Of course, the track on the bike and on the run almost always seems to head back to the one place, the Rainbow Bridge. Beautiful Rainbow Bridge, 798 meter suspension bridge.
Selvesberg, European bronze back in 2016. This is second Olympics, having gone in Rio, where he finished 16th. Got a world ranking of 44 coming into this. And the group of 38 behind snake their way through the course.
Look how relaxed he is up front. He's on the aero bars and not quite taking in the sights, but, I got sick of riding in the pack. I'll have a go up front. It's an incredible situation that is setting itself up for this run.
Yeah. Fluid, calm, controlled, just pushing the gear. It's made him comfortable and getting away from the others, it gives him a clear run at it. No real concerns on the corners when the brakes are applied, and he may bunch up a little bit. The Swiss, absolutely efficient in his riding and out of the saddle just to get over that incline. And he's established a bit of a gap, nothing significant yet, as it's
still sharp, I think, from Canada, who's doing the bulk of the work at the front of that pack. So you get your spot in here and away you go. You don't need really any assistance because it is, well, pardon the pun, but it's a ride in the park, the Odaiba Marine Park, just at the moment for these Olympic athletes, as someone has to lead, and Selvesberg says, I'll do it. Head through the tunnel in a minute, build up a little bit of speed, and there's Toth in remaining his place in the back. Wilde's jumped on board, which is important when you talk about those that are good runners. Hayden Wilde is certainly one of those. Jacob Bisselwhite from Australia, Mislachuk from Canada, Moeller,
Alex Yee,
there are plenty of them, aren't there? Morgan Pearson. There are plenty of them.
There are.
But if you knew that, you were very, very happy in this pack. You were very, very happy sitting here. There are some others that would be thinking, what am I doing? What am I going to do here? And again, the form line is the form line, but it, And we did mention earlier, it's not ridiculously hot, but it is still tough out there. And it will get to some. There'll be some that have better credentials that won't be able to compete at the level of others who, on paper, shouldn't be there come the run.
Well, it's almost pedestrian, isn't it, going around?
It's an enormous pack and it's a hairpin bend, I'll give you, but goodness gracious.
Down to a crawl, and it's allowing the Swiss Salvesberg to establish a comfortable gap.
Here he is. Comfortable is a good word. That's exactly how he is just at the moment. Anticlimactic, the bike league here in Tokyo 2020, but it can and will change very, very quickly.
I think it was always likely with such a technical course that it was going to be difficult for anyone to get away in a meaningful way or for a group to establish a lead. And there was the opportunity at the beginning when Vincent Louis and Schumann and a couple of others, a group of four or five, emerged from the water, but they never went about it in a definitive way, and the gap never grew beyond 10 or 12 seconds. And once they couldn't establish, the chasers were organized. It was a group of 20, 25, and they did a pretty straightforward job of closing that gap down.
The lead will be interesting here. It might have crept up to 300 meters or thereabout. Salvesberg was almost at the finish line. No, he wasn't. He's there now, and that group is about 100 metres into that, onto the blue path. So he's doing it all on his own. He's doing it relatively easy, but he's built himself a lead that they'll have a little bit of a think about. 21 seconds, it's not too bad. And here's that enormous pack. They're all coming through. So that lap, 7 minutes exactly. So starting to pick up the pace now. So 15 seconds faster than lap six at the bell. So because it is so technical and tight, they're thinking about transition already. You can't wait till the second half of this 5K bike race, which it's become, if you like, the 40Ks, eight laps of 5K, so there's less than 5Ks left. So Salvesberg will hold on to the lead, you'd think.
No doubt. Salvesberg on his own, a group of 36 behind him. That is, well, in a field of 51.
Yep.
We'll call that a peloton.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Going, the road race was going faster than they are now, that's for sure. And looking at the rear of the field, any of the big names that are gone, it's Morgan Pearson of the USA who's out the back, and he's got a 15-second penalty still to come. He doesn't know about that. That's, he'll enjoy that when he finds out. But other than that, all of the main brigade are there.
And now the mines and the focus turns to transition and getting in, delivering the bike, and getting on the run as smoothly as possible and finding the rhythm. They will, with such a big group, be jockeying for position. They've got to get off the bike, remember, that line on the blue carpet. Make sure that they don't get themselves into the position that Pearson has got himself into and get a penalty that would end any ambition they had at a podium finish. But they will be thinking it through, mentally visualizing what lies ahead in 4 or 5 minutes time. And all the while, Salvesberg at the front, the Swiss. And that lead will be his going into the third and final discipline. 1.5 kilometers of a swim already under their belts, heading towards the final moments of the 40 kilometer cycle, and then the transition to the grueling 10K run. Temperature now about 29 degrees, humidity late 60s, early 70s%, and even the fittest, most conditioned athletes, these are challenging moments.
As Gundam watches on, the field starts to think very much about transition. And then the 10K run, four laps of 2.5K. So not dissimilar to the bike, it is pretty quick. There's something happening all the time. You're constantly turning. The blue beach path, it begins on five turns, two straightaways, and then back onto the beach path to finish. They'll do that four times. So they'll always know where everybody else is. That's one interesting part of this track, as does this chase group. Great images from above. Odaiba Marine Park, small island in Tokyo Bay, south of the city, linked by the Rainbow Bridge, and the biking around West Promenade Gardens.
Salvesburg giving it significant effort in the final part of this bike ride. He's up out of the saddle and he just sees the chasing bunch coming around that final corner before the hairpin as he heads down the road and tries to extend that lead. It's a gap that's going to have to be bridged, be it 20 seconds, 25 seconds. Yeah. They're going to have to come and get him.
And he's going to push now, because right now, this minute, we can't see him, but he's heading downhill. So he's at the fastest part of the course. The red line, trying to red line the bike, as will these guys. As you can see, they're stretching out now as they jockey for position for transition. They'll disappear under the tunnel in a moment as well.
It's a sight we haven't really seen in
they've
the
stretched
bike race.
It. They've
it's,
stretched it, haven't
it's
they?
Stretched that the pressure's come on at the front and it's created that tempo that sends them in single file. As
Salvesburg now out of the tunnel and up the hill. That's the last chance, if you like, to try to get something on those that are coming behind.
He's
work
driving
up that
now.
Hill faster than the others can. And, yep, he's nearly there now. He's only got, once he gets around this hairpin bend, there are just two more bends to go before he's back onto the blue ramp, the blue path that heads back along the beach. So he can see exactly where the field is, and he's starting to think about those legs. What have they got? Have they got enough to get me an Olympic medal?
Approaching an hour and 14 minutes since the off of this triathlon. And an hour and 14 minutes in, we will head to a grueling 10K. It's a flat course. Grueling will come with the heat and humidity.
And with this gap, of course, we have to start to think about what Salvesburg can do. 2020 Swiss national 10K champ, so he's not foreign to the run at all. Motivated by Swiss success in triathlon. Could have one of his own in the not too distant future, as it's the business end of the bike now in terms of getting off it and getting onto the run and into transition. Got a 400 meter lead as we can hear the bell ringing. There he is.
Not the cleanest of dismounts, but nonetheless, it is there for him. Salvesburg will park the bike, deposit the hat, on with the runners, all in 3-4 seconds. The hat is there and he's off and running. As the group behind look for their spots, Yee, 55, number 55, Brownlee there as well, Blummenfelt, all the favourites, all lined up.
Everything has to go into the box. If your glasses, your helmet, something doesn't go in, you get a penalty, so you can lose it there. And that gap, 14 seconds now, that Salvesburg has over again a number of athletes that are in the running, but how did they come out of transition? So important.
Vincent Louis was not the cleanest in transition, and they're all taking the opportunity to take a bit of a shower on the way through.
Yeah, interesting. 7 minutes 10 that final lap, and they were going. So that was 10 seconds slower than the 7th lap. So the heat's starting to have an effect. Of course it is. While they had the opportunity to at times, just let the wheels go round, the entirety of the now 1 hour and 16 minutes of this race in these conditions, while not as bad as it could have been, it's still tough out there.
And you saw a shot there of Matt Sharp, who was at the front of the group on the bike. Well, he looked spent, didn't he, at the back of the runners,
and you know,
coming out of transition.
You know who's gone already. You can start to see those who can't quite hang on, the importance of being part of that second pack. Now, you said it was... Oh, you said it was tough. He got off. Did he get off just in front of the line? If he didn't here, as the brakes went on, if that... He's off. He's... Oh, is he? The foot was on the line as he was still arguably on the bike. Now, that's a tough call. If he crossed that line, if they call it that he crossed that line, he will receive a 15-second penalty.
And we didn't see that live. We just came and joined it when we saw that... What looked like a dismount
that he was clumsy,
was difficult, and it was clumsy.
And not until you see it in super slow-mo. And he didn't mean that. That was the skid of the bike on the blue carpet there.
We'll see if a penalty comes and what the judgment is, but it was oh so close one way or the other. Now, at the front of this run, there are the two young men already establishing themselves, and we wondered if it got to this position, whether they would come to the fore. It's Alex Yee from Great Britain, and also the New Zealander
Hayden Wilde.
Hayden Wilde is
an excellent runner. He, because of watching the Olympics 5 years ago, not 4 years ago, decided I want to be an Olympian. He's a good runner, cross-country runner. That's my way to get in, and he's taken to the sport and taken to it exceptionally well, and he's comfortable here. He was third in the test event in 2019 on this very, very course. So he'd be very, very comfortable. He knows this position. He'd be really backing himself in. But
well,
look, they've caught him.
They've eaten up the gap. And Salzburg is spent as the leader of the triathlon. And the group led by Yee with Wilde there. And also the Norwegian Blummenfelt. The other Swiss, Max Studer, also to the fore.
And that's good of Studer to jump in front of his countrymen now and say, hey, you had a crack, you did the work, you can sit behind me if you can. I'm not sure that he can. I think that bike took a fair bit out of him, so the penalty may not matter despite his nice heritage as a 10K runner. Although, again, just jump in here, try and rest a little and see what happens. There's going to be a push soon. Blummenfelt and Yee at the head of the pack. Some athletes just like to be out front. They like to just roll along. They're happy for someone to be in behind. They just like to be there.
Brownlee, about fifth or sixth in that group of runners at the front. Schumann there, the bronze medalist.
Here it is again.
Salzburg.
He fell off the bike, didn't he? Yeah, I think they're going to suggest that's a penalty, but I'm not sure that it matters. I think that bike took a fair bit out of him, as there's an image of the rest of the field safely through the beginning of transition, and this is all important. Just grab the water. You don't have to drink it. Just use it to cool down.
That was Vincent Louis, and then Mazo, the Syrian athlete, Mohamed Mazo. Oh, the pain. At the front, it's Yee with Wilde on his shoulder. Alex Yee, 23 years of age. World rank 14 coming into this. One in Leeds, where he announced himself as a medal contender in the early months of this summer. Has been in the shadow of the Brownlee brothers, but at 23 years of age, he is emerging, and behind him, another to emerge, young Wilde of New Zealand. Hayden Wilde, 23 years of age. As you said, third at the test event here in 2019. He's got a baby face, but he's got the maturity of a hardened triathlete. And you can see sunglasses are on. He's in the zone. His form is good. And the two young men lead the way at the front, emerging Kevin McDowell of the United States in behind them, wearing number 52. Terrific story, McDowell. Diagnosed in 2011 with Hodgkin's lymphoma, 6 months for chemotherapy. Now a seven-time World Cup medalist, and he's at the Olympic Games. What a remarkable story.
So they too now head back towards the start-finish line in the run. As you can see, Bert Whistle just dropped off a little bit, Eden as well.
The three Spanish athletes, the world number one, Mola, the experienced Javier Gomez and Fernando Alarza, all three are off the pace, the early pace set at the front by Yee and Wilde.
So the first of the four laps is about to conclude, the 2.5Ks, and Yee leads. Wilde is there, Connex from France, Studer, Van Riel, who's so good on the bike but didn't really get the chance to sell it, Blummenfelt, McDowell, Mistelchuk, the test event winner. He's right there, as is Brownlee. He's never anywhere else, is he? Vincent Louis is there, 4 seconds behind, and then a little bit of a gap to Reed. So it's starting to shape a little. There are some, as we thought there would be, there are some names that were hard to calculate. There are always going to be some athletes that perform in these conditions better than others. And we may be seeing the changing of the guard in Olympic triathlon in front of our eyes.
Dorian Connex, 2013 junior world champion, the Frenchman, 27 years of age now. 36th in Rio. And mixing it up at the front 5 years later in Tokyo.
...7.46 the time for the first lap of the run.
It's the Frenchman from the Briton, the Norwegian in third place, Kristian Blummenfelt.
Anyone in that frame
from the United States.
Almost anyone in that frame there can still medal. You can see they're just starting. It's a big pack and there's a small gap. There's a couple of packs, but then that straightaway there starting now. They're hanging on, but they're starting. You can see they're tiring.
Vincent Louis looks to be in little trouble for me at the back of that group. There were nine and then another three, and you can see him behind Schumann. Through he comes, and he's off the pace
a little,
of
isn't
the
yeah.
run at this stage.
Yeah, he's got Brownlee just in front of him. And do they decide to, and he's also got some other support, so they should be able to get back on, but this next couple of minutes will be interesting, won't it? These guys won't be thinking about breaking anybody up behind them. They're just worrying about themselves at this moment.
It's
2, 4, 6, 8, 10.
10, indeed, who have established themselves at the front, who are setting the pace, setting the tempo. And Yee and Wilde have done so since transition. They just gobbled up the lead of Selfosberg, the Swiss, who came into transition clumsily but comfortably in the lead. The transition was clumsy, the lead was comfortable. And
good call. And Yee out front, that's where he wants to be. He said during the lockdown period, he worked really hard on his mental state. handling the pressure. And I think out amongst all of that, he's happy to be, okay, I'm happy for them to know that they've got to chase me. I'll just produce whatever I can produce.
Well, when you've been in the shadows of the Brownlees, when you've learned from the Brownlees, when you emerge from behind that, you come with significant credentials. And that's what he brings. And Wilde, he looks so comfortable. His style is, well, they're both also very slight men in terms of the builds of those around them, and you can see the comfort in the style of both of them by comparison. McDowell is really digging in. They have the look of 10K runners, Yee and Wilde.
And Wilde's just getting rid of the headband there. That's not just a headband, it's an ice band, if you like. It's cool to try to assist him to cool down, and he might be about to grab another one. He grabs some water. The athlete from New Zealand just behind Alex Yee at the moment. No, he's just decided to get rid of it. He might get one back. Because of the heat, the extra heat here, coaches are allowed to provide the athletes with some nutrition and assist them in a couple of specific parts of the course. 2, 4, 6, 8, 9. So 10's become 9.
There's two Britons there.
We've lost one of the Canadians. Yep. As there's another 4 that are just trying to hang on. Yee, Wilde, Max McDowell, Studer. There's some names that'll be a surprise to many that are in that pack. Stornis looked like he was about to drop off, but he's held on. Blummenfelt just moving himself up into 4th place. Brownlee there at the back. Don't forget Brownlee. How could you? It's Johnny. Alistair not in the field, but here in Tokyo. He was standing for a position on the Athletes Commission during one of the IOC conferences. Not sure whether he got it, but I bet he did. He doesn't lose much.
It's been stretched, though. You can see it.
9 now.
It is a pace that asks the questions of.
So Brownlee's gone and Louis couldn't go with him.
Yeah, absolutely.
Brownlee's joined and Louis has dropped off.
But this is the pace being set now by Wilde. Yee comfortable with it as well, but it's asking the question of the physical state, the mental state of those behind. Can they continue to live with it? As the two young men, one from New Zealand, one from Great Britain, just ratchet it up a little.
Now, hard to tell in that picture. There's Vincent Louis at the lead of the second pack. It would look a bit closer than they actually are, I think. We'll get some time soon enough. So there is world number 3. Lanier has also just fallen away in that pack trying to tack on, and that's a better look at it there. We can't see that second pack in that shot yet. So there they are, just in there now. So the gap's okay, and this pack starting to find its way in, but maybe into a top 4.
Yeah, I think those that are behind this group of 9 with the pace that's been set by Wilde and by Yee are going to find it near on impossible to bridge that gap if the two young men at the front can keep this tempo going. And as you say, a group that was 10 became 9 and is now fractured further. 4, another 4, and 1 dropped off the back as we come to the end of the second lap of 4 laps of 2.5K. It's Lee, McDowell, the American, Wilde, and Blummenfelt. And then Brownlee is 7th.
Stornis and Van Riel are in there as well. And then there's the gap to Louis. So he's 12 seconds back. Keep an eye on that.
It's the Frenchman, Konix, who has fallen away. And we're down to 8 at the front. Then a gap to Konix, and then another 3.
Coming back to the number
So a fast lap, 6:30 and a little bit more.
Frenchman looks spent, doesn't he? His form is gone.
Yep, he does. Can't really find it from there, can you? There's really eight still in the hunt as they turn left there and head onto the street circuit. As we look back to the transition area, and there's the red line of the finish, about 100 metres to go from that red line to the finish line when they get there.
Well, you might have heard the on-course commentator talk about mental fortitude, and it's a really well-timed thought at this point in the race. It's a battle with yourself as much as those around you, as the physical efforts start to take their toll. And
yep, Connex falls away, Studer potentially falls away, and again it looks a little closer than it is, but Louis has some assistance, although he's having to do the work himself, so it's going to be hard. If anyone can do it, he can do it.
Behind him, another gap to the world rank number one, Mario Mola, who's emerged from the pack and is picking them off one by one.
Yeah, well, he often has the best split times. He often has the best split times wherever he finishes in the run. So yeah, he'd have to get some help as they head along, that's for sure. McDowell decides to just tell Yee that he's there and move up alongside of him. A smart move from the American. It's a dangerous game to read too much in the body language, and the glasses help Alex a lot, but he just looks completely calm and cool and like he knows exactly what he's doing. He's certainly exactly where he wants to be. That was his plan, so that's the best part.
Luis and Mola ranked 2 and 1 coming into this race. Mola looks very comfortable, doesn't he? And Yee has taken over the lead once more with Wilde behind him, and then behind him it's the Norwegian Blummenfelt, then McDowell of the United States. They are the four as Alex Yee looks to increase the tempo. Beautiful stride. Wilde equally comfortable behind him. You look at Blummenfelt and he looks like he's struggling with this pace now, as does McDowell. Yee has absolutely increased the tempo.
Form is a wonderful thing. In 2021, there's been limited opportunities to race in the World Triathlon Series, but Alex Yee's form, he won in Leeds and then was fourth in Yokohama. So he brought in the best form, ranked number one for 2021, albeit just over the two races. So that says something. And Wilde also, via the test event, which is a little while ago now, he was third in the test event right here on this course back in 2019, a test event what was to be a 2020 race. Johnny Brownlee was top five then.
And he's top six now.
Yep.
There are six that have broken away. A group of 10 became a group of 9. We're down to six. And Johnny Brownlee has been at the back of that pack, that lead pack, the whole way through. When somebody struggles, he simply picks them off and goes to the back of the lead group again. Blummenfelt decides to let the young men in front know that he is still about. The 27-year-old winner in Yokohama in 2021, winner also in Lisbon earlier this year, world rank 3 coming into this, 13th at Rio, and it is bubbling up nicely for what will be a frantic race for medals over the final lap of 2.5K.
Blummenfelt, a junior cross-country champion, loves the run.
Looks cumbersome in his style by comparison to both Alex Yee and Hayden Wilde. But it's effective. And a gap opens up.
Yeah.
Between the first three, and Brownlee manages to navigate his way into fourth place, just picks them off as they drop off. Can he bridge the gap? Because Yee has now increased the tempo again. And Blummenfelt digs in behind him. Wilde has looked comfortable and composed through this run so far. And Brownlee, all that experience being called on now, all that training, those years and years of commitment to the sport, understanding how far he can push his body, how to deal with the pain and the discomfort, and he is dragging himself back to those three.
They run past the Yoko Elementary School to the right, and that means there's one more turn before they hit the blue path, the ramp over the beach that heads back to the start-finish line. They'll do it two more times. This one for fun, and then the next time when they're here, it is the business end. There'll be about 500 metres to go when they get back to this very spot. So there's still four in it if Johnny can hang on. And, of course, the top three are no lock to remain in those positions or to remain up the front. The conditions, the tough conditions today, and it's getting hotter, and that humidity really starting to take effect. Anyone could stop, but they have put a sizable gap now in the rest of the field. It'd be a big effort to pick them up. Brownlee struggling to hang on now as we've got the top three heading to the bell lap.
Yeah, the former world champion, the silver medalist from Rio, the bronze medalist from London, 31-year-old Johnny Brownlee. Brownlee, is he broken? Is he beaten? He's going to have to find something special from there as Yee and Wilde and Blummenfelt head towards the final lap of this Olympic triathlon, almost called it a marathon.
It's a marathon effort from these guys, that's for sure, particularly these three leaders who are in each other's slipstream here. And do they work together to ensure that they get the medals? Do they go, right, the three of us can do this, no one will catch us if we work as one? Or with just 2.5 k's to go, do you say, bugger that, I'm here for gold, I'm on my own? I think it's the latter, not the former, as Michalchuk crosses the line. So they catch some water, all important to do that. The race is well and truly on here. They just come up the rise before they turn left and then left again onto the street circuit, where there are five turns and two straightaways. And then when they get back on that blue path, there'll be 400 metres to go. This race is really cracking now.
And the analysts and the experts before this race, they of course talked about the Molas and the Louise and all the
There's Mola.
Form that had gone before, and you looked at Brownlee, but all referenced the rising talents of Wilde and Yee. And here they are. And you talked about a transitioning from the old guard to the new guard. Well, the evidence of what we've seen so far, Taylor or Hayden Wilde and Alex Yee, well, we will be seeing them at the front of many a triathlon from here.
All right, it is on. There's no doubt about that. It is on. It's so tough out there. Alex Yee talked about the imposter syndrome of competing with the Brownlees. He trained with them for a little while, and of course it was what they did in London that motivated him. Hayden Wilde watched in Rio and decided, I want to do this. I want to go to the Olympic Games. Well, if he holds his form, he'll be better than that. He'll be an Olympic medalist. And Kristian Blummenfelt, his second Olympic Games, 13th in Rio. He's one that enjoyed the extra year off. The postponement of these games really helped him. He wasn't in the greatest of shape. So, you know, it's not surprising that you sit here and look at where he is.
He is absolutely digging in, is Blummenfelt. You can see in the style, it's not as fluid, it's not as comfortable, but it is equally effective. And he is the one with the experience of this group of three in terms of longevity.
Who makes the move? Who decides to go? Wilde just lets them know that he may be new to the sport, but he's as tough as they come. National endurance racer. He's made for this.
Mola has had a decent run and come through numerous athletes, but has never really been challenging for medal honours. And there's a gap there.
Yeah, Blummenfelt just starts to go, decides this is the time I'm going to test out the youngsters and see what they've got. Yee's the first to respond. Wilde, can he tack on? He needs to find something quickly. See, there's a gap now. Yee's going to really have to work. Is this the moment? Kristian Blummenfelt, he goes for Norway, the 27-year-old, looking around his left shoulder. The pain on his face says this is going to be tough. We know it's going to be tough. Has he gone too early? He's certainly gone. He's testing the youngsters, and they're strong. They're hanging on.
Well, what an effort after an hour and 42 minutes. Blummenfelt goes and goes deep to try and break both Wilde and Yee. And he has a little look over the shoulder and he digs in again.
He's talked about wanting to break the 7-hour Ironman record. Now, that's ridiculous. That's how tough he is. As we look back at Pearson, that's that penalty that he suffered out of the transition of the swim. So 15 seconds he stands there and then he'll be allowed to go, but he is way back. We return to Blummenfelt, who maybe has put 15 seconds or not quite, but on Yee and Wilde. This is a big move. He is really going for it. He is going to set up an Olympic championship if he can continue this.
He's absolutely put the hammer down and Yee is trying to get to him, but Blummenfelt has just delivered a killer punch at a crucial moment, and he has a little
Perez.
Look.
He's nearly there. He's lapped Perez there. That's why he's in the frame. He looks around, and all of a sudden, he looks a little bit fresher. It's amazing what that gap can do. Really gunning for it now. Kristian Blummenfelt from Norway. He will turn shortly and head back onto the blue carpet that will take him home.
Still a mighty effort from here. The job is not done and he will know it.
The race for the minor medals, Yee and Wilde. We haven't seen them for a little while. They've certainly dropped back. I don't think these guys, including Jonathan Brownlee, will be able to catch them and get involved at all. Here is Blummenfelt. Yee at the moment in the silver medal position. Wilde the bronze, and it may well hold out like that. He continues to have a look. Does Kristian Blummenfelt.
Blummenfelt absolutely committed. And he has shown them a clean pair of heels.
And this is it. He turns now onto the blue carpet. He can see the finish line from where he is. Yee in the silver medal position and Wilde as he laps Perez in the bronze. So it looks like that's where second and third will be. What about Blummenfelt? Let's have a look at the leader once again. He's got 250 metres remaining now. He is home, Kristian Blummenfelt. This will be fun for him. There he is, coming down, about to lap someone else. 250 to the aid station. He won't need any assistance. Wow, he starts to think about what he has achieved. He is powering away from Yee. He will turn now into the final straightaway. And fittingly, 100 metres to go from here. The best 100 metres of his life. What a way to do it. He has blown them away. He can't believe it. Kristian Blummenfelt, number 3 in Olympic rankings, number 2 in the world, and about to become the Olympic champion. How about that? Blummenfelt blossoms in Tokyo. Triathlon gold for Norway in 2020. What a magical finish, and Yee will take silver for Great Britain. And what about that, Hayden Wilde, the bronze?
What a finish. Blummenfelt, he had a look at what was around and said, I'm gonna go. And when he put the hammer down, when he asked the question, the two young men who finish in bronze and silver positions, Yee and Wilde, they looked so comfortable, but they had no answer. And it was a hard man from Norway who delivered gold. And now the minor placings as Brownlee comes across in fifth position. Van Riel takes fourth. McDowell and then Bissak and Eden, the Norwegian. Good day for Norwegian triathletes, first and eighth.
Big run from Eden to come back, and you could see what it took out of Kristian Blummenfelt there at the end, and just wonderful to see the young men come across to him.
Mola eventually comes across in 10th place. Great run from him. Luis in 13th. Nainer, the Japanese former Australian who showed on the bike, finishes in 14th. Mislachuk, the man who won the trial event here, finishes 15th on the big day. And Bert Whistle is the first Australian to cross the line in 16th place.
There's the winner. There he is, Kristian Blummenfelt. He can't move. They are all exhausted as they cross the line. His second Olympic Games, 13th in Rio, and now the gold in Tokyo. Magnificent. Hold back on the swim was his strategy. He wasn't hopeless in the water, that's for sure, but he was just so dominant on the run. And look at them as they cross the line. They are all out on their feet, and the medical staff very quick to get to the Max Studer in particular discomfort. And Blummenfelt, there you go. He can't move. He cannot walk another step. 51.5 Ks and maybe half a metre, and that was it. He was done. He's now on the wheelchair just for the moment to calm down and cool down. They'll pump some water into these guys very quickly.
Yeah, they are well used to bringing themselves right to the edge, these triathletes, but they are also very quick to recover once they get themselves settled at the finish line. But the immensity of effort is visible for all to see. You train for weeks, months and years to arrive at the elite start of a triathlon, and when you get to the end, you have given every ounce, and that is good enough for each and every one. They will know they gave of their best. And in the end, it's Blummenfelt, the Norwegian, who takes the gold medal. It was Britain in Rio. It was Britain in London. It is now Norway in Tokyo who take gold. And great medals for both Yee and Hayden Wilde, and that very much the future of triathlon, the present as well, it has to be said. But you would expect that we are going to see these two young men for a long time to come.
They continue to cross the line at now the rear of the field. As you can see, almost 4 minutes behind Kristian Blummenfelt, who blew them away in that sense. Norway's first ever Olympic triathlon medal is a gold medal. And well, what a way to take it in. The medal ceremony might take a while. These guys will be cooling down. They'll be getting ice all over their body, and lots of water pumped into their body.
We saw as Blummenfelt came into the final yards of the final lap that he was catching some of those at the back end of the field. So Perez and one or two others found themselves at the back of the course, which means they're 2.5 kilometres behind the eventual winner, as we have 38 of the 51 starters home.
Schomburg, who was up there in the early stages, just comes in now, and there's still five or six remaining to come through. So, well, an incredible test of strength it was.
Yeah, and you make the point, 38th position for Schomburg, then at the beginning of the cycle, on the first lap of the cycle, he was in the lead group of four or five and finishes off 4.5 minutes down. His compatriot Nischlag comes through in 40th position.
And this is how he crossed the line. Look at that steely resolve. He showed it. He looked like he was doing it tough in that last lap, but that's just who he is and how he does it. He loves pain. Well, he sort of does. Like, that's why you do this sport, to put yourself in the position to enjoy it just like that.
The ecstasy of agony and a gold medal around your neck.
What a great line. And that's it. He took about three steps, and that was all. If the line had been in a different place, these guys wouldn't have got there. Not quite, but you talk about leaving nothing on the track. Well, we knew that coming in. And I think we were lulled into a false sense of security this morning. It wasn't that hot. The humidity wasn't too bad. The forecast was that it would be okay. It was as rough and as tough as everyone thought it would be.
And that the very reason that they moved the race back to a 6:30 start local time, which was a big ask for the athletes, although they will be used to training in the early hours of the morning and long training days.
Yep.
To compete and to perform at 6:30 in the morning was a big ask local time, but they did it, and it was for the right reasons. And there are the young men who took silver and bronze. And I'll be seeing you, brother, seems to be the message for many a year to come.
For a long time. That's Hayden Wilde in the black from New Zealand, and giving him the most incredible hug. A medalist hug, an Olympic medalist hug. Not many can do that in Olympic triathlon. Alex Yee from Great Britain. And there's the man with he won't wipe the 43 and the Olympic rings of his arm for a long time. Kristian Blummenfelt from Norway. The gold medalist is Pearson from the USA, who had that extra sold into the wound of the penalty from his transition after he dropped away after a pretty good swim.
Yeah, many talking about him as a potential medalist. Pearson finishes in 42nd position, 7 minutes down. Polianski, one of the two brothers, in 43rd. And there is the man who led on the bike on the third lap, Zakos of Luxembourg, 7 minutes and 17 seconds down after another huge effort.
And we know Nabil of Austria didn't finish because of a bike accident. Henry Schumann also won't finish, the South African. Something occurred during the run leg, I think, and he injured himself and pulled out. But this man finished, and he finished first. He finished as the Olympic champion. He fell to ground and basically hasn't returned since. Kristian Blummenfelt, he can take as long as he likes. For the rest of his life, he will be an Olympic gold medalist. Yes. What a great image. It didn't work for everybody, including those that are coming across the line now. And just to be here at the Olympic Games and get around this course in such tough conditions is a victory.
Mehdi Esedik is the latest finisher in 45th position from Morocco. And there is the Canadian Matt Sharp, again another who featured in the lead group on the bike.
And Matt Sharp is going around at the end of the field with the two that will not finish. So that's the vision of Sharp, who will be the last one. Perez, we saw, was lapped by Blummenfelt just before the finish. He crosses the line. Now the Mexican, you talk about hot, he lives in it, and this is what it does. Japan has been absolutely brutal, this triathlon track and these conditions.
And Mazo, the Syrian, 9 minutes and 8 seconds down. And Russell White from Banbridge in County Down in Ireland will finish the race in 48th position. White, 9 minutes and 36 seconds back of our winner, Blummenfelt from Norway.
And that leaves just Matt Sharp to come from Canada. Those that weren't able to perform, or amongst those that weren't able to perform in these conditions, and that's the sport of triathlon. Sometimes it is just not your day, but the number one and two in the world, Vincent Louis, was in 13th position in the end, 1 minute and 20 seconds back. He was there and thereabouts, but just when it started to come, he certainly couldn't go with this man. And Mario Mola, 10th position for him, 1 minute and 9 seconds back. So as expected, well, as he often does, he picked up some time late in the run, that's for sure. So that's what happened when Yee took the silver, congratulated the gold medalist, and then turned around to see Nathan Wilde for bronze. And what a great image that is. The young Brit, great performance. Looks like he could do it again.
Well, there is a brotherhood in the triathlon and a sisterhood, obviously, in the women's event where they understand what it takes. They know what they've done to get to where they are, and the respect amongst them is, well, it's obvious, not just today, but every time they show up. Interesting to see the time, finishing time of Blummenfelt, 1 hour, 45 minutes and 4 seconds. And you compare that to the win in Rio, which was 1 hour, 45.01 when Alistair Brownlee won. So similar time, similar pace, 1 hour, 46 minutes and 30 odd seconds, won the gold medal in London. And of course, it's course dependent. It depends on whether the course has got flat runs and what sort of bike course was on offer. We thought it might be a little bit slower because of the technicality of the bike phase, but 1 hour, 45 minutes and 4 seconds is the winning time of Blummenfelt.
There it is. It stands at the top of that list as we bring it in to Russell White with Matthew Sharp about to arrive. He toughed it out, the Canadian, and here he comes. He did a lot of the work on the bike and looks okay, but that body distraught. He crosses the line, the last to do so, some 12 minutes and 20 seconds behind the winner.
Matt Sharp is the last to finish the Tokyo 2020 men's triathlon. Victory for Norway, silver for Great Britain, bronze for New Zealand. The first of three events in triathlon at the Odaiba course. Confirmation, Kristian Blummenfelt, the Olympic champion from Norway. Alex Yee from Great Britain takes the silver. Hayden Wilde of New Zealand in the bronze medal position. World rank number one, Mario Mola, only good enough for 10th on this day. The many fancied Vincent Louis of France in the minor places. And down the board we go. Javier Gomez in the 20s. Oscar Coggins of Hong Kong, the youngest starter today, finishes 33rd.
It's carnage when you get back to the bottom. Those times are jumping out a lot. The course just ripped them apart in the end. Interestingly, the final lap, 7:26. So despite it being the final lap, that was almost 50 seconds slower than the one before. So giving their absolute everything, they had zero left. They had absolutely nothing left. And we saw that as, well, not just the winner, as everybody crossed the line. Fuji Media Center there forms the backdrop. It's impressive, isn't it, of this wonderful course.
And here's the story of the men's triathlon at the Tokyo 2020 Olympic Games. Diego Moya of Chile led them out after a false start, a rare false start in triathlon meant we had to restart the race. And then, well, it looked ominous when this man, Vincent Louis of France, made his way to the front out of the water and into the bike phase, the 40 kilometers on the bike. And when Louis hit the front, we thought maybe it was going to be the Frenchman who dominated the race. But the bike meant that the field, rather than fracture, came back together again. There was a bunch of four or five that then became a bunch of nine and eventually ended up at a peloton of 30.
And interestingly, that allowed someone like Blummenfelt, who was 25 seconds behind off the swim, to catch up quickly and to not only catch up but to conserve his energy and hit the transition along with the rest of the field. With Sulzensberg out in front, he was wheeled in pretty quickly on the bike in seemingly pretty good condition.
Salfsberg was the one who made the transition from bike to run first, but it didn't last long as Blummenfelt and Yee and Wilde. And then it was the Norwegian who in the final 800 metres delivered the killer blow and claimed gold in what was a terrific race.
The Tokyo Bay has never looked so good. Well, for some, for others, they might not want to come back. But for Kristian Blummenfelt, Alex Yee and Hayden Wilde, when they step up onto the podium to accept their medals, looking over that view and those rings, wow, just absolutely incredible. Looks serene, it looks pretty cool and calm, but the conditions in Tokyo at this time of year, despite the time of day, make it brutally tough. And that's how it played out in the Olympic triathlon. Gold to Norway, silver Great Britain, and bronze New Zealand.
So the calm after the storm of the race at the Tokyo 2020 Games. And it was a race that engaged from the very beginning. And we look forward to two more events in triathlon at these games. The women's race tomorrow at the same time. And then the mixed relay event later on in the week. That is what we have to look forward to. And if the standard and the engagement is anything like we had in that men's competition, it's a mouth-watering prospect indeed.
The victory ceremony for the men's individual triathlon will commence shortly.
Mesdames et messieurs, la cérémonie de vainqueur du triathlon individuel homme.
Ladies and gentlemen, the victory ceremony for the men's individual triathlon.
皆様、ただいまより個人男子トライアスロンの表彰式を行います。
So then, the medal ceremony for the men's triathlon is ready to go. They are fully recovered. They looked in ecstasy and agony at the end of that race, but Blummenfelt, who found it hard to get back on his feet having crossed the line, is up and moving and excitedly walking towards the podium to receive his gold medal.
Led by the bronze medalist Hayden Wilde from New Zealand and trailing in behind Alex Yee, the silver medalist from Great Britain. What a moment this is. Norway's first ever Olympic triathlon medal, New Zealand's first ever Olympic triathlon medal, and with the silver for Alex Yee, Great Britain goes to the top of the table with six medals since the triathlon competition came into being at the Olympics back in Sydney in 2000.
You see the wind has got up a little bit in the bay. It'll be interesting to see how that might impact tomorrow's race. So then, onto the podium to receive his bronze medal from New Zealand. It's Hayden Wilde. 23 years of age and an Olympic bronze medalist.
Set up a sauna back in New Zealand so he could train in the heat and try to replicate what he was going to come into, because he got stuck in back in New Zealand because of COVID.
It's not a Brownlee, it's a Yee who wins a medal in the triathlon for Great Britain. Alex Yee, 23 years of age and an Olympic silver medalist.
He was 14 when he was on the roadside in London watching Alistair and Johnny medal, and he wanted to do it. He has.
Whether it's announced in English or French or Japanese, Olympic champion, gold medalist, has a wonderful ring to it. And Kristian Blummenfelt of Norway, the culmination of a triathlon career,
called Alistair Brownlee his hero, the two-time Olympic triathlon gold medalist. I think he needs to find a new hero. You can't stand on the same spot as your hero, can you?
Ladies and gentlemen, the anthem of Norway.
Thank you.
mesdames et messieurs, le médaille est olympique.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Olympic medalists.
They can't come together, but they can take the mask off for the prettiest of pitches. I've won a gold medal. I can do whatever I like. He calls the silver and bronze medalist to stand by his side.
The medalists make way, the flags are lowered, and the venue departed by gold, silver and bronze on a memorable day for the men's triathlon at the Tokyo Olympics.
The Rainbow Bridge there in the background, it's a beautiful course, it's a technical course, and it was always going to be tough, and it was super tough, and only the best survived, and they were Kristian Blummenfelt, Alex Yee and Hayden Wilde.
The images that tell the story of an hour and 45 minutes and 4 seconds that it took Kristian Blummenfelt to claim the gold medal at the Tokyo 2020 Games. 1.5 kilometers on the bike, 40 kilometers of a cycle, 10 kilometers of a run. And at the end, it was the Norwegian with a gutsy, strong performance who claimed gold. Yee for Britain with a silver. And Wilde from New Zealand claimed the bronze.